Welcome to Spec Ops Gear, special weapons and tactics for civilians. Today, we're talking about the Zastava M92 PAP. This is a long-term review. 10,000 rounds over 8 years. Some people will call this rifle the Suchka, the Krinkoff, the AK-47U. A lot of times I'll just call it the Krink. And yes, I did say rifle. Mine is a registered SBR with a stock on it, and it is proud of its identity. This gun is sold as a pistol in the United States with no stock, and in the year 2021, it's gotten a lot more popular for people to go ahead and just put pistol braces on their M92s, and thus legally keeping the firearm a pistol and not having to mess with any of the paperwork of creating an SBR. And so usually people would keep it in pistol configuration. Mine's a rifle. It is what it is. Like, let's get over it. What's the TLDR on this? The M92 is a delightfully crude beast. It spits huge fireballs, and you can actually put lead on target up to about 250 yards away. It's short, it's nimble. The best use case for the M92 is probably as a truck gun. And it's a lot more accurate than you might think. Downside to the M92, probably the big muzzle flash makes it not my top choice for things like home defense. It's not my top choice in really enclosed spaces because the big muzzle flash will put quite a bit of noise back in your face, and it's also less ideal to have that muzzle flash at night. The M92 is a Serbian-made Yugo Pattern short-barreled AK. It is marketed and sold in the United States as a pistol, and the two things that are most common with it right now, probably most people just go ahead and put a pistol brace on it, or if you're like me and you want to sign your life away to the ATF, you can make it into an SBR. Short answer, should I buy one? Is it badass? Yes, it's badass. Sure, you should buy one. They're great. And it's pistol configuration with no brace. It's more of a fun range toy than a serious piece of kit. With zero brace, with no stock, anything like that. It's more like a pistol grip shotgun. It's fun, they're iconic, they're probably in a lot of movies that you saw when you were growing up. It's badass looking, and it's cool, it's fun. But really, my review centers on the M92 paired with either a pistol brace or folding stock. This review is going to assume that the owner of this would go ahead and just make it into an SBR, mount a commonly available pistol brace to it, or etc. Also, dear ATF, yes, I have a stamp. Please don't shoot my dog. Pop culture, video games, movies, they have a lot of myths about AKs. There's also a lot of myths about short-barreled rifles that you might see come up specifically in say, like video games about the mannerisms and specifications that you'd get with a short-barreled rifle, and specifically short-barreled AKs. People would say that AKs are inaccurate. That's not true. People say that SBRs are inaccurate. That's also not true. AKs, including this SBR, are usually about 2 to 3 MOA, depending on the ammo, which means that in a perfect world, you could probably get about a 2 or a 3 inch group at 100 yards with this rifle. The other thing that people will say about short-barreled rifles, or whatever, a pistol with a brace that shoots a rifle cartridge, is they're viewed as having a very limited range. That's also false. I can hit silhouettes out to about 250, maybe 300 yards with this rifle using a dust cover mounted aimpoint micro. I've had this rifle for about 8 years. I've probably put at least 10,000 rounds through it. For several years, this rifle was in my primary rotation. Almost a decade later, I still love it, and I would never consider selling it or trading it off. Is the M92 PAP reliable? Yes. AKs in general are very reliable, and the Zastava M92 is no exception. For shooting stuff and requiring minimal maintenance, it's excellent. That said, AKs in general and the Zastava M92 are not going to have United States tolerances. It was designed in Soviet Russia, and it is riveted together in a basement using sticks, rocks, and it's quenched in the tears of sweatshop workers. The design of the AK entails big gaps in the dust cover. This can allow pieces of gravel and other debris to get in the gun. If gravel gets in, it's going to malfunction. What do? Rack, swap out a new mag, rack it again, get back to work. It might be a little bit crunchy, but it'll generally work. The shorter length of the M92 compared to a standard AK-47 is great for portability, and it's really good for ingress and egress from vehicles. In its pistol configuration, you might have better luck legally carrying it concealed in a backpack or in your truck, depending on your state laws. In some states, you can legally conceal a loaded, quote, pistol, but not a rifle. You're probably not going to carry this M92 PAP directly on your person in most cases, but if you have a quick access locking mechanism to stow it in your truck, maybe under your seat, something like that, then you might be able to have this secured in your vehicle. Maybe you deal with an active shooter situation or without rule of law, kind of a get home gun type thing in a severe event. That would probably be the best practical use for the M92. Why should you get an AK-47? AKs are reliable, they're simple, and they offer an alternative ballistic profile that's very similar to 300 Blackout. It's a slower, heavier bullet, punches through barriers better than 5.56 NATO, and it makes sense to train on alternative gun platforms. So even if an AR-15 is your primary, it makes sense to at least have some training on AK variant rifles, because sometimes the rifle that you have may not be your rifle. You need a gun. You do not need your gun. Depending on how a situation develops, you might not have the luxury of having your own firearm in that emergency. It could be that you're forced to use a battlefield pickup. Maybe your rifle was damaged. You could have a very reliable AR-15, but if your AR-15 takes a stray bullet through it, then it could put your AR-15 out of action. There could be other situations where you were given an AK as a loaner gun. So there's a lot of things to consider, and you should at least have basic familiarity with the function of different types of weapons. Around the world, AKs are one of the most commonly available rifle, and until very recently in Afghanistan, an AK might be the most commonly used firearm of the Taliban. That is until the United States government gave them truckloads of M4s. One of the other things to consider about possibly owning an AK is ammo availability. Now, currently as I'm filming this in fall of 2021, AK, Russian AK ammo is a little bit harder to come by, the Russian ammo ban, but when you zoom out on your time scale and look at the last few decades, surplus and imported Russian steel case ammo has usually, in most ammo shortages, been cheaper and easier to find than your NATO cartridges like 9mm, 5.56, stuff like that. It was in 2013, 2014, you could not find 22 long rifle to save your life. But you could get cases of AK ammo and keep practicing, keep training, and just get out and go shooting. Right at the moment, Russian ammo is hard to find, but that has not been the case over time, and I do not believe it to always be the case in the future. If you own several firearms, having a few AKs around as a backup can make sense. For the last 20 years, it has been easier and cheaper to stockpile bulk commie ammo than standard NATO cartridges. Speaking of ammo, there's some fun things that you can actually do with the AK that I wouldn't necessarily recommend, but if you're really into reloading and you take responsibility for your own outcome, like, you can actually go ahead and make subsonic AK ammo and run it through your silencer. So if you're looking at putting a suppressor or a silencer on your AK-47, your M92 PAP, it's a lot of fun, but just FYI, you will need to be aware that AK threaded barrels can be off-center, and this off-center will mean that your suppressor is on there crooked. And if you shoot a bullet down a crooked suppressor, you're gonna get a baffle strike and ruin your suppressor. So that's one thing. Another thing to consider is that although it's possible to make subsonic AK ammo, the twist rate in the M92 PAP is not ideal for stabilizing heavy cartridges. Did I do it? Yes. Was it successful? Yes. Is it going to be the thing that I would just recommend for everybody? No, probably not. With the twist rate of the M92 and the other factors involved. If you do it wrong, you could send the bullet out of the barrel tumbling and ruin your shiny new can. That's fun. That said, the AK cartridge, the 7.62x39 cartridge, is actually very, very similar in terms of case volume, in terms of the weight and size of bullets that you can use. That's very similar to the 300 Blackout. For myself, I started with subsonic 300 Blackout loads, went very slowly, and made some recipes using CFE Black reloading powder that is made for subsonic 300 Blackout cartridges. Other fun details about the M92. The M92 is made in Serbia. It's imported as a pistol. Because it's imported as a pistol, it doesn't fall under US import laws, specifically 922R. What that means is if you go and you buy an AK-47 rifle, it is going to fall under 922R, and that means that it, when it comes into the country, it has to have 10 out of 20 very specific parts that are made in the United States. This law, 922R compliance, is actually a holdover, I think, from some of the early 90s, like the Clinton era assault weapons ban, try and curtail the import of kind of budget-friendly modern sporting rifles. I think they were taking aim at stuff like the SKS and maybe even some of the Norinco AK-47s, which, by the way, if you can find one, those are pretty neat. So they made this law to make it to where you had to put a bunch of American parts into your imported rifle. And being a pistol, the M92 PAP can legally come into this country with all of its factory imported part. It's nice because a source of unreliability for a lot of the AKs available in the US, the fact that they have mixed parts of, say, guns that came in from Serbia, guns that came in from Poland, Russia, China, other places, and they mixed those with parts that were made in America. And a lot of the American made parts, honestly, were not made to the same specifications or the same quality as the parts that would come from the factory. An AK rifle with all of its original factory parts from the factory that built it is going to be inherently a bit more reliable or have less failure points than one that was sent to the US and that somebody just kind of haphazardly put a bunch of American-made parts in to just kind of get by some stupid laws. As a, quote, pistol, the M92 PAP has, I would say, a higher inherent reliability than rifles that are imported under 922R. There are different opinions on whether or not if you convert your M92 PAP from a pistol to a rifle, there are different opinions going around on whether or not you would actually need to add your 10 parts, your 10 US made parts, to go ahead and make it 922R compliant. I'm not a lawyer. I'm not giving you legal advice. If you're the ATF, I have a ton of American parts on my AK. Don't shoot my dog. If you're not the ATF, I don't know, do whatever you want to do. Or just put a pistol brace on it, keep it a pistol, and keep all of the commie spec parts on it, and don't use American parts for your gun internals. That's about the 922R and some cool benefits of getting an AK M92 PAP pistol as compared to a rifle. M92 PAP, what are the problems? What's the catch? In short, I really love this rifle. With any rifle I love, there are going to be some things that aren't my favorite. Even on something that I love, there's going to be drawbacks. The short barrel of the M92 PAP does mean that it has a lot of muzzle flash. So you only lose about 200 feet per second, so you can still reach out 250 yards pretty easily, hit human-sized targets, whatever you want to do. That's not the downside of the short barrel. The downside of the short barrel is that that shorter barrel makes it shoot giant fireballs. So while those are fun, and it might be kind of neat on the range, it can also, if you're trying to shoot fast, trying to shoot multiple targets, etc., it can tend to distract and disorient the shooter. In a without rule of law situation or a self-defense situation, you may find that that large muzzle flash of the M92 PAP could disorient you and it could give your position away. The muzzle flash is going to be especially relevant in enclosed spaces. Other problems with the M92 is that it is ridiculously overgassed. the big bang muzzle flash would be a big downside if you're using it as a home defense gun, trying to fire down your hallway during a home invasion. If you were in urban combat, something like that, using it in enclosed spaces, maybe a stairwell, stuff like that. If you were doing that without ear protection, you'd probably get permanent hearing loss. Those are some things to consider. As for the overgassing, there's a few different solutions. One, you can just run it as is. It'll kick more than it needs to, but it's not unreasonable. So as for the M92's overgassing, you got a couple different choices. A, you could just run it as is. The recoil is going to be a little bit more harsh than it needs to be, but overall it doesn't kick that bad. Other things that you could do about it, you could go ahead and get an adjustable gas piston from K&S Precision. I think they're $100 or $150. The third option is you could go ahead and just notch out a section of your gas piston. I'm not recommending that you notch your gas piston, but what that would do is go ahead and bleed off some of the excess gas pressure, similar to what you would see done with a K&S Precision. The problem with cutting your gas piston is A, if you have any warranty, you don't need more. B, it's a one-way ticket, so if you remove too much material on your gas piston, then your gun won't work and you've got to find a new piston. Those are your biggest things. And then also, anytime you're doing your own modifications on something, it's kind of a, you're gonna get what you get. It might work out great. If you're inexperienced or you kind of do it wrong or you have bad luck, you know, you might ruin your gun. The safe way is just to spend the money and go ahead and get a K&S Precision, but I don't know, if you want to take a chance, go ahead and just trim your gas piston and reduce that over gas pressure for free. Free so long as you have a file. As for dealing with the large muzzle flash of the M92 PAP pistol, the other thing that you can do is go ahead and run some type of muzzle device. I've tried a few. I tried the Manicore Arms Night Rake. I tried just running nothing on it. And I also tried the Soviet Spec, what's known as a booster. So the booster is a muzzle device that extends out from the front of the barrel for a few inches, and it tapers down, and then it has a flared end. And the booster is probably the best thing I've found to send the muzzle flash and all that excess hot gas and just direct it away from the shooter. So my top choice would be the Soviet Spec booster that you would see on the rifle in most of my pictures. The Manicore Arms Nightbreak actually does a really good job with mitigating recoil. It reduces the visible muzzle flash by quite a bit. So if you're thinking about shooting it at night, it makes that muzzle flash a lot more tame. The downside of the Manicore Arms Nightbreak and probably all the similar, you know, kind of compensators, muzzle brakes, muzzle devices that you might find for the M92 is that it makes the gun a lot louder. So for me personally, I want to be able to shoot in enclosed area. Maybe I'm shooting in and around vehicles, enclosed spaces. Maybe I have to shoot down a hallway, stuff like that. So I tend to be pretty sensitive to like overly loud rifles, like even for my three gun rifles, for competition rifles. I do not personally run the big old compensators or anything like that. Yes, I know they reduce recoil and probably would allow you to get your follow-up shots a bit faster. For me, I find that the extra noise of compensators just isn't worth it for me. So your mileage may vary. The Manicore Arms Nightbreak, definitely good at reducing recoil, good at reducing muzzle flash. For me, it was a no-go because of the noise. Maybe you're okay with the extra noise, and it's perfect for you if that's so, rock on. AKs in general do have some issues. You're not going to get the same level of ergonomics that we in the US have come to expect from modern designs like the AR-15. It's harder to mount accessories on an AK, so optics, weapon lights, stuff like that, customizations, it's harder to customize an AK. The AK-47 does not have a last round bolt hold open. There are a few magazines that will give you a semblance of last round bolt hold open, but it's just not the same. Basically, when the gun runs out of ammo, it's going to go click instead of bang. The reloading procedure of the AK is a little bit more involved than an AR-15 due to the AK's lack of bolt hold open, and the AK has a rock-in type magazine, and then you will need to cycle the bolt to reload. The other thing to consider when you're looking at AKs is that unlike mil-spec AR-15s, AKs are made in many different countries around the world. They're made in different factories, and they don't always interchange parts. M92 PAP bolt and forend is different than many other AKs. And also in general, Zastava and Yugo-made AKs, as they're called, have some different parts like the bolt, the stock, the forend, things like that on Yugo pattern rifles and pistols in this case are a bit different in spec. That said, they've been importing Zastava rifles in the M92 for at least a decade now. There's a lot more parts available than there used to be, so that's not as big of a problem as it was in the past. AKs are not as ergonomic as an AR-15. They're not quite as accurate as an AR-15. They're not as customizable as an AR-15. That's all true, but don't let the above dissuade you from getting an M92 PAP, training with one. With some training, with some adaptation, with some personal skill, you can mitigate or overcome most of the downsides of the AK. And if you do a lot of training, a lot of dry firing with your AK, you can get really good at the reloads and your weapons manipulations, and that'll take you a long way. Are you gonna lose half a second or maybe a second here or there if you're using your AK in three gun? Yeah, you probably will. But can you still effectively run and gun with an AK, with an M92 PAP that's been SBR'd, with an M92 PAP with a pistol brace? Oh, yeah. As for the muzzle flash and recoil, there's some things you can do about it. I've given you my best advice with it. It's fun. It's a fun gun. In summary and in closing, the M92 PAP absolutely rules. Short-barreled AKs absolutely rule. It's short, it's handy, it shoots big fireballs, and you're still able, even though it has a short 10-inch barrel, you're still able to make hits out to 250 yards. The M92, it's small, it's nimble. Probably the best use for it would be as a truck gun. And it's also, it's just plain cool. If you've played video games, you played Call of Duty, you've seen, was it like the AK-74U? If you've seen like James Bond movies, things like that, a lot of the action movies, you would see villains and stuff like that would carry AK variants, including AK-SBRs, Krinks, Suchkas, stuff like that. It's just a fun little gun. It's neat. It's fun. I love my AKs. I love the M92 PAP. It's a neat piece of gun culture for a collector, for a casual shooter, and it's also a serious bit of kit for those that are into disaster preparedness and want a really good truck gun that's short and nimble. So that's my review.